Gloomhaven Jaws of the Lion is coming to Target this Sunday, which is hopefully today when I release this video. It plays 1 to 4 players. It is a fully cooperative, immersive scenario, story-driven game. You're going to be playing this dungeon crawler as either 2 players by yourself, or everybody will play their own unique character. And in Gloomhaven Jaws of the Lion, much like the original, this game is going to allow you to choose between these 4 characters that are all very, very different than the other ones, and they all will function in their own unique way. Are you going to be playing as the hatchet character that is ranged and also melee using his hatchets? Or will you be playing as the demolitionist, where you're dropping bombs, destroying debris, and cracking holes through walls to let you and your allies get through and do some devastating damage to unsuspecting enemies? In the game, you're playing with scenarios that play over about 2 dozen different scenarios, and you're going to be progressing 1 at a time, and the game will get more complex as you go through. Unlike the original Gloomhaven, this one here is going to be a little bit more for the standard audience, people that are going to see it at Target and retail stores, to give you just enough of what you all love about Gloomhaven, but also making it palatable for those players who are just getting started. Now, of course, that doesn't change the complexity and the legacy aspect of the game. In the game, you'll also be getting unique legacy opening boxes that will allow you to unlock new secrets, new miniatures perhaps, and additional cards that will let you upgrade your character and the enemies themselves. When you progress, new enemy standees will pop up on the board that you'll be using on a booklet as opposed to tiles, allowing you to set up the game board. You'll be setting up things like traps, as well as coins, unique and different types of enemies, whether they be the elites or the basic ones, as well as chests that you'll require to loot, and cards will let you do that. The same unique combat system of this game is inherited and still feels different and unique each and every time I play through each of the scenarios. I went through quite a few of them, and I'm happy to say we can discuss all of them, but before I do that, I'll take you down below. I'm not going to explain the full game or how to play everything. There's a bunch of videos out there that are going to do that way better than me, like Watch It Played. I strongly suggest you check those out, but I will give you the full synopsis of everything you're going to get in the game, and then we'll come up and I'll discuss what I think about the game without actually fully playing through any Gloomhaven. I have the game, I know how it functions, I've seen how it's played, but I haven't personally played it, so this will be a unique perspective probably for some of you that haven't actually played Gloomhaven, and whether you want to pick this game up in Target as well as in the link down below in the description. All right, let's take a look at the game. Welcome to and welcome back to the world of Gloomhaven. Whether you picked up the original game or not is not needed for this game. However, it is an expansion to the original from what it says on the box, as well as its own standalone game, which is what I played, and I played up to about 5 or 6 scenarios, which should give you a good enough understanding of the game, hopefully, and give you guys some perspective as to whether or not you should pick this game up if it's something for you. This is pretty much everything the game entails, other than there's some stickers, and I did punch out a couple of them, even though I played much farther than that, as well as in the box here, there's additional cards and other tokens and whatnot, and the map for the game. This is the map of Gloomhaven. As you can see, you'll be sticking little stickers on here as you complete your different scenarios throughout the game. Also note, there's a bunch of additional rules guides. There's the main rules, there's a supplement scenario book, and there is the basic glossary, which tells you everything you need to know about the game. If you have any rules questions or concerns, you can go through this, and it's got a bunch of little rules, helpful tips and whatnot that will kind of progress you through the game if you have any questions. Okay, so let's dig into this thing here. And like I said, I'm not going to go through the rules, but I will explain how it functions and how it feels and what you're getting. So over here, a bunch of tokens, mainly all of the enemies. There's some chests and some traps. You've also got some debris things that like will open up as you destroy certain areas on the board. You'll be using certain tokens. And there's also tokens that will allow you to note when you've opened doors in certain areas as well. There is markers in here. Some of them are going to be initiative markers for the enemies, which tell you whose turn goes where and when based on your initiative. There are your debuffs and buffs, whether they be poison or whether they be shot in the knee, as well as you're going to have other unique markers, something like this here, the little frost symbols, poison or damage counters, and then, of course, your coins. Coins in the game are very valuable because they let you buy certain things throughout the game. This is your scenario booklet, and it's got up to about 20 plus scenarios in it. And as you go, you just basically flip pages. I went ahead and set up scenario 3 because I think it gives you enough to know what the game kind of feels like and looks like, but not too little and not too much to really sink your teeth into. Your characters are going to start in a certain area with these little doors here. Enemies will start in certain areas based on the rules, and of course it has a 2, 3, and 4 player marker, and you just place your enemies there based on literally what it shows you. So setup is very easy for this game. It takes almost no time at all to actually set up the scenarios, which is very nice. I don't know how hard Gloomhaven itself is to set up for a scenario, how long it takes, but this one, bam, really quick, especially if you have everybody using their own characters. The coins are put in place, as well as the traps, and I would have hinted at the damage on top of the traps to denote how much damage you take when you get them. There is, of course, the introduction. It talks about the special rules, and whenever you go to certain areas on the board, whether it be one or two, busting through doors and revealing new enemies, you are going to trigger certain events that take place, which is really cool in this game. The supplemental handbook is also going to have some unique scenario attachments. So, for instance, if you're doing a specific scenario, it might have you attach this portion of it to the actual scenario, making it that much larger and the game a little bit more engaged, complex increase and length increase. This is for you. Each player is going to pick one of these guys, whether you want to be the hatchet, the demolitionist, or the two other characters, which you probably see somebody else's rules or review to know what those guys are. I won't go into too much detail on them, though. We'll save a little bit for your unique opening of the box. You're going to have legacy aspects of the game where you're going to open these up as the game permits you to. I went through and I already opened up one of them, and it's unique. They're basically things that are going to support the storyline of the game. Cards that you're going to use for each of the different enemies. These are decks that will show their the initiative of the enemies as well as what they can do in accordance with their base stats. And base stats were on these things here. You place an enemy inside here to note their level and then their stats. And of course, the levels will increase throughout the game. Or if you want to make it easier, you can decrease the level of the enemies. And there's a front and a back to them, which is nice as well. These are all the different enemies in the game that you'll be using. And of course, they also have front and backs. And then you have your health and your experience tracker. You have each of the decks for each of the characters you can be playing, and if you're playing a one-player game, you'll have two characters that you choose from. These are items that you can buy at the end of every scenario, and it'll have a cost, and it'll tell you whether they get lost after you use them, or whether you can use them more than once throughout the game, or if they're just simply passive. Everybody's also going to get this unique deck of cards that basically consists of what you would think dice would be. But instead, you'll be drawing off of this deck of cards and getting pluses or minuses, or even possibly times two or misses, which will increase or decrease damage that you do as you take your actions. The actions in the game are very, very interesting. You get this whole hand of cards here, as well as this player reference. You'll choose two of them. You'll use a top and a bottom from two different cards. Choose one of them for the initiative, and then you're set to go. And the enemy will do the same thing as well as everybody else. You'll reveal these two cards after you've revealed your initiative and say, okay, I'm going to do attack 2 and range 4. And then on this card, I'll do my stun and target an adjacent enemy and potentially do a poison. And that's pretty much exactly how combat works. As you run the deck out, it'll discard. It'll all discard as you play the cards. And when you get it back into your hand because you have no cards left, you'll have to randomly discard a card into your discard area or your lost area. And then you'll have the rest of your hand, which will then slowly discard as the round goes on. So you can lose in two different ways, whether you get exhausted from having no cards left or if your health goes to zero, like a normal RPG or dungeon crawler. So that is how the time goes through the game. So even if there's no enemies on the board, you still have to use those cards to move, which can then slow your progress and potentially make you exhaust before reaching the end. Pretty simple how it works. You'll be moving across this board here, which is literally just this pamphlet here, and you'll be fighting your enemies, removing them. They'll be dropping coins. You'll be entering doors, and when that happens, you'll trigger them, and then you'll read some unique scenario. If you land on a trap, you'll smack it and you'll suffer some type of damage. There's things like the terrain that's very difficult to go through, which would make more than one movement point in order to get through it. Or you can jump across it if you have certain abilities. Then there's basically stuff in the way, obstacles that you can destroy, but only maybe if you're the demolitionist and he has a lot of bombs and stuff. And for the most part, most of the scenarios are going to involve you attempting to defeat all of the enemies in the specific scenario. As you do that, new things will trigger. Things I won't talk about exactly for sure, but there's things like the city blessing or the city events that will take place, and you'll get to choose how the story goes. You'll discard that card and never use it afterwards, which is always going to be different each time you set up and play this campaign because of the way you interact with those cards and the fact that you don't use them again in that campaign. And that's pretty much the style of the game. Certain characters are going to get unique little tokens, and you'll upgrade as you play each new scenario. New things are going to come into play. You're going to have cards in here that you'll upgrade to form a better and more unique deck. You'll also be able to upgrade your traits or talents by removing some of these plus zeros, or even minus ones or minus twos in your deck, making you stronger and better as you continue playing the game. Once you've completed one scenario and done everything it tells you to do, you'll take everything off here, and anything that you've collected, like loot and whatnot, you can go ahead and buy certain items. There's decks of cards that will let you buy certain items throughout the game, and you'll move on to the next scenario. And it will tell you how to set everything up. There's another board that explains where everything goes. Bam, 5 minutes later, you're pretty much ready to go, provided you understand all the rules that are new to each specific scenario, because new things pop up. After about the fourth or fifth scenario, you've pretty much got all the rules and all the unique things to the game. There are a couple things that you can look up in the scenario booklet, but pretty much you're ready to go, and you can go ahead and experience the game Gloomhaven Jaws of the Lion for yourself or with up to three other players. A very, very exciting game. I've got a lot to say about this game as far as my review goes, and I think it's one of those games that you're pretty much already, if you're on the Gloomhaven side of things and you like Gloomhaven, this is probably one that I would imagine you're going to pick up. And if you're somebody new, which is probably more of what I am going to be experiencing here as my review goes, this might be something for you to take a look at as well. Found in Target. Description. Let's go. Let's talk about it. Most of you know what Gloomhaven is, and Frosthaven for that matter as well. The second addition to Gloomhaven, like a separate standalone new game that came out on Kickstarter. And this one here is basically the retail version, but it's separate from those two. Yes, it can be, there's certain things that can be added from this game to Gloomhaven itself, but this is going to stand on its own. You can go ahead and just go straight to Target, pick this game up, and jump in. You don't need to know any other rules about the other two games or anything like that. You can just go ahead and play this game, and it does an exactly amazing job at explaining how to play this game. The rules and everything laid out are wonderful. Playing the first scenario starts off pretty blasé. It's pretty simplistic as far as just learning how basic combat works, how movement works, how the enemies kind of function. And then as you get into round two or the next scenario, it starts adding unique little twists to it, adding things like the long rest, which will allow you to basically get cards back from your discard pile at a certain cost, and it also gives you HP, but you don't get to act in that round, taking damage from an enemy, and so making tough choices comes as the progression of the scenarios goes through. You'll be leveling up in the game, allowing yourself to choose certain traits and gain certain bonuses and unique cards to your deck. It's a light deck builder in the term of you're only going to have a certain number of cards in your hand throughout the entire game, and for me it was 10, but you're able to kind of customize those actions and then choose to decide how you want to use those actions in what kind of coordination. You want to use card A and card B, and then one on A and two on B, or vice versa. And how do you want to interact with those? Do you want them to have the initiative of 12 or 50? You don't always want to go first. Sometimes you want to go last. And that's another thing too. You can't necessarily tell your opponents, your teammates, exactly what you're going to do. I'm going to use this specific card and this specific action and time things. You just have to simply play them saying, oh, I want to attack the rat dude over there, or I'm going to go over here and bust through this wall. You can say things like that, but you're not going to be able to do that. I'm going to use, you can't scientifically, mathematically do that. You're going to simply play the cards face down, flip over, check the initiatives of not only yourself and all of your allies, but also all of the enemies, put them into an initiative, and then go at it, go through that round, and then play again. The decks start off small and things are pretty simple, but as you build up into about the fourth or fifth scenario, things start getting the ramp up speed, things start getting a little more in depth and longer, and the scenarios start getting more intense. Yes, you can lose in this game, and you can lose in two different ways, and when you lose, you simply restart the scenario, keeping all the stuff you had prior to that scenario, and if you win, you will advance onto the next scenario and push yourself further into gameplay. If you're playing this by yourself, you can choose two of the characters and you can kind of go throughout the entire game that way and then choose two of the other characters and do that, because it kind of lends itself to having separate boxes that you'll be unlocking and opening as the game goes on, and each of them are very, very unique to each other. This game has a lot to offer and there's so much to discuss, but for the most part, I just want to let you guys know that it starts off pretty easy and allows you to gradually learn the rules and learn the unique aspects of the game that make it more challenging and more difficult as you go on, which works great because that means almost anybody can play this game. As long as you enjoy dungeon crawlers and you like tactics-based games with a unique combat fighting system that does not involve dice, Gloomhaven is going to be great for you. Now, would you prefer this game over the original Gloomhaven or even Frosthaven? I don't know. Is this game going to be different? I mean, there are certain things I've noticed just on the fact that the base game has these specific tiles that you're placed on the board, and you're going to set up these really large maps and whatnot. But in this game, you're simply going to be using this board here and flipping over as you continue, and it has everything written out for you. So is it a little lighter? I would imagine yes. Yes, it is probably lighter than the base in the second game, Frosthaven. Is that a bad thing? Not necessarily, especially when I get somebody new into this game or new into this hobby and you want them to get into a dungeon crawler, this is going to be great. It's not just, like I would say, a starter game. This is actually a game that starts off startery and pushes it past the limits of that, allowing players that in general would never play a game that has that starts at like the sixth campaign of this game, like something more like Descent. We have to kind of learn everything at the very beginning, and it kind of pushes you a little bit. This one is gradual and very, very nice, and the setup is beautiful. They actually made sure that this all functioned very, very well. The artwork, it's Gloomhaven. You guys know the artwork for this game. In my opinion, it is excellent. You guys can decide for yourselves, obviously, but everything in the game as far as artwork is concerned is very, very beautiful, fantasy-esque. Yes, one thing I can say about it is one of the cliche style, fantasy style, Lord of the Rings kind of feels to it. Paladins and golems and goblins and rats, and you're playing with, you know, the cultists and whatnot. But what's also interesting too is the characters are very, very unique. I never thought I'd be playing as the hatchet man, throwing my hatchets at enemies and picking up my favorite hatchet to do additional damage. Pretty cool, actually. It's some really unique aspects to that specific character. The Demolition Man, how he actually is literally going around blowing stuff up to make it easier to get through, as well as doing damage to enemies. So those characters are actually very unique to the style of theme and like genre, I suppose. But the game itself has that basic feel. So that's gonna go one way or another for you. For me, it was just, it's fine. You know, I prefer things a little darker and things a little more Cthulian or HP Lovecraft, but I'm not going to complain. This game does a lot. This is probably, in my opinion, the best dungeon crawler I have ever played. And this is just, this is the Jaws of the Lion. This is the retail version. So some people in the comments might be going, Michael, you don't understand. Gloomhaven and Frosthaven are this big, huge thing, but I haven't played those yet. But this made me want to jump into that game because that game looks scary to me. All right, it looks like there's a lot going on, a lot of setup, a lot of rules. But after playing this, I now feel much more comfortable going in and actually opening that up and sitting down and playing a game and teaching people how to play the game, which is another reason why you might want to check this game out. Basically, for those of you who really want a great dungeon crawler with a legacy aspect that lets you open new things up and change and customize, this is definitely, definitely a game I would suggest. I like everything about it. All of these standees are thick, all the components are very nice. None of the even little things that I like to complain about usually, like you sticking this thing in here, in general will like scratch this. This thing will get like worn off. It doesn't do that. You can put it on and off, and you don't even see the wear on it. So it's really, really great detail, really, really great quality. And all the pieces are here that you need. You're never gonna run out of a specific piece, at least as far as I played in throughout the game, and it gives you enough to where you're not needing to worry about that. And teaching people how to play is so simple because the rules are literally right in front of you, spelled out and thoughtfully created, and the glossary. I could go on and on about this game, but it is genuinely a piece of art. And I now understand why people were so intrigued by Gloomhaven itself. Just playing this one here makes me want to even jump into the next one. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to finish playing this game here first, fully. Then I'll go into that one. And then maybe I'll get Frosthaven if I'm not 60 years old, because there's so much content in both of these games. Oh, Gloomhaven, I finally did it. I jumped in and played one. And of course, it's this one. It's a little easier for me to get involved with, but I'm so happy I did, because now I feel a little more confident jumping in. You Twilight Imperium players out there, and you Gloomhaven players who just simply could jump in and do it, very, very, very impressive. For me, though, this was a great starting point, and I think you should pick this one up for your friends and families, especially if they're new to this gaming hobby, this great industry that is blossoming new and new, more and more players as the game goes on. Oh, I'm tired, and it's hot in here. As time goes on. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. If you're interested, check out my Unfiltered unfilteredgamer.com website, we're giving away two games right now, Dragon Lords Battle for Darion, and I believe another one that may or may not be off, so I'm not going to be too for sure if it's still there or not, but take a look, it's on the giveaway section, you can't miss it. New blog posts as well, putting up more stuff that involves our Callie's Corner videos. And every Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. PST on Twitch and Facebook, we stream live games just like this one. And in fact, this Wednesday, we'll probably play this one because it's so simple and it has such a unique aspect to it. I think players are really going to dig seeing it live, determine whether you want to pick it up or not. So this Wednesday, the Sunday after it got released. So if you want to pick it up before then or after, you can check out my live stream. All right, guys, that's all I got for you this time. As always, I look forward to playing games with you next time.